What's going on? It's the kid Travis Dimitri, and this is a whole new episode of Our View. Here's the gang.
What's up? I'm Twist Francis, Harlemite in the house. What's up, y'all?
Aussie Danny's back, week number two. Cannot wait. Boom.
So unfortunately, Justin cannot join us for this, but we got a special guest host, Mr. Brandon Carson, actor extraordinaire. What's good, boo?
What's going on? Thank you guys so much for having me. I'm excited to be here. I just feel good and great and, you know, ready to show, you know, look, tell my view on our view. So this is fun.
Ooh, I like that, Brandon.
Let's do it.
1, 2, 3, 4. Everything is not what it seems to be. The world's changing. Everybody's asleep.
We're doing a nice big talk show, so I need to look intelligent. Come with my glasses on. I'm gonna make my intelligent glasses.
Okay. Yeah, you tell me why.
Lord.
Something's telling me for the perfect world. By old world.
All right, y'all. So let's get right into it. Let's start with Tory Lanez versus Meg The Stallion. So you know he shot Megan Thee Stallion on the foot 2 times, allegedly, and she put like an order protection on him. However, he still considers Megan his friend. So my question to you guys is, have you guys ever dated anyone crazy? And if so, like, what are the warning signs, you know? And what did they do? Like, what's really good?
Who's gonna go first? Cause
go.
We don't let Brandon get a guest of honor. We don't let you go first. Let you have this. What's up?
Bring it, Brandon.
Okay, people of the church, we first have to acknowledge a few things. Okay, number one, I feel like the way that Tory Lanez has not only dealt with this situation initially, like his initial reaction to it, it was piss poor. The team that's behind him and the way that they decided to say, you know what would be great? Let's go ahead and make an album about this situation, as opposed to actually just going about it and expressing exactly what happened before this motherfucking girl and her team come and tries to, take us to court. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Because at this point, it doesn't make any sense. So the fact that he's coming back now and saying, oh, you know, I can't really talk about it now. You go live after the music. And then it's kind of just, which still doesn't really tell a story. It just alludes to a lot of different things, which is also stupid and weird to me. I just feel like for him to go on and be like, oh, we're friends, blah, 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 so on and so forth, you know, now and this and that. I can't really talk about it now. I'm in court. It doesn't, it's weird. It's just weird. And it just makes no sense. So I feel like this all is deranged.
I agree. I feel like this whole situation makes absolutely no sense to me. First of all, none. Why are you shooting somebody in their feet? Like, I don't understand the logic of
have you ever dated somebody crazy?
We've all dated somebody crazy.
What? Have any of you all been shot from somebody crazy?
No. That hasn't happened.
That's a whole other level.
That's intense. True. Usually, yeah, I'm like the crazy one. I'm not shooting nobody.
I don't think I've ever dated anyone that's even owned a gun. Like, I don't think I've ever dated anyone. Like, I've never been in any kind of violent situation. So, like, no, I've never been shot at. This is just crazy to me.
Like, what would be a warning sign to y'all? Like,
here's one warning sign. I dated a girl once, and this will tell you everything, boys. She was from New Jersey. I should have known, but I'm a foreigner. How could I know? She waited till I fell asleep one night. This is a true story. She waited till I fell asleep one night. She took my phone. She had purchased like an FBI program where she plugs her cord into my phone and she can download, wait for it, deleted messages, photos, all sorts of stuff that you think you've deleted, can download that. She did it after I'd fallen asleep, loaded it into her computer, and then accused me of all sorts of nasty things.
Was it true? Because she was accusing you. Was it true?
What are you about to say, Toys?
You said accused, but she had proof. So is it
an
accusation?
Hold on. She has the receipt. Proof. I said she downloaded. I didn't say there was any. tangible evidence. You guys are like horrible judges.
I feel like she's crazy. Like,
I didn't know. Like,
I'm trying to find out what that software was. Shit, I need some of that. Yeah,
here's the thing. The messages were not all pieced together. It was like bits and pieces. Like,
you're trying to making excuses, Dan. You're making excuses, Dan.
It does sound
I would not have been judged guilty.
I dated a crazy African stripper one time, and he pulled up to my house, but I'll leave it as that.
That's not a story.
I'm not going to tell you what she's dead, because that would be definitely
Wait, you can't, you, no, that's not fair. You can't just, you know, go ahead and just
drag Okay. So, forget that. Can we be friends with your ex?
It depends. You know, I don't want to see you anymore. I'm very petty when it comes to breakups sometimes. You know, I'm very much so like, block them here, block them there, block them here, block them. Because what I'm doing, like, initially, just trying to get you out of my head. You know what I'm saying? So I'm not trying to see you or hear from you or anything. But honestly, I think it's subjective. It just depends on, you know, how you break up.
That's better than me. I need time to kind of break away and get you out of my head. We need to, you know, for me not to be angry anymore, for me not to want to stab you in the eye, and then we could be friends after that.
Violent.
Well, I'm not shooting anyone in the feet or anything like that, but, you know, I need time so that doesn't happen.
What is next on our list? You lost him a stab in the eye.
Okay, so since COVID, many of us have been working remotely, and Zoom has become the new conference room. So it's great because we can work in the comfort of our own home, but some of us might be a little too comfortable. So recently, Jeffrey Toobin from CNN was on a Zoom call with his coworkers and was seen masturbating.
Ooh.
Kidding me? He claimed that this was unaware, that he was unaware that he was on camera. So, I mean, what do we think of this, y'all? Like,
he's a liar.
What would we do in this situation? like, what do we do? What would you do in this situation? Like, let's say you get caught up in this whole thing. Like, we kind of get started up here, and then it's like, oh, wait, Travis, what?
What are you talking about? And it would be Travis.
It would be Travis.
But I'm not that dumb.
Put that in there, right?
I'm not. You did, Brandon. I'm not that dumb because. One, like my sister first, like my sister, she has a habit. She tapes all of the cameras on her devices because of CSI, because she don't want to get spied on, right? Two is that, yes, with Zooming at home, like me personally, like, you know, it's we do get comfortable and, you know, sometimes I'm more lazy or whatever. So that's a little bittersweet. Three, boy, you lying, because when the cameras are on, regardless of what device it is, you see a light.
but also keep in mind that Jeffrey Toobin is 60 years old, so he's an old man dealing with technology.
At least he's still masturbating. Shit.
I mean, well, the masturbation part, no, there's no excuse for that. I can't.
It's weird. Like, it's weird. Again, it's weird.
Let me say, like, I have to Zoom all the time for work. You know, during the day. So, like, and since I've been home, I'll be home in my drawers. I'll put on a shirt and I would just hop on my laptop. Oh. So, but I do, like you said, that, like, I have tape over my camera if I don't want to be on camera, or, you know, but do you always see that light? So I don't think it would ever happen to me. Like, but even still, like, I would at least put drawers on. Like, I'm just not going to be on, even if there's a possibility, I'm not going to be walking around with everything swinging around. That's not, just even a possibility. I need my job. I need to collect this check again.
Have any of you been, and you have to be honest now, have any of you been caught, like Jeffrey Toobin, masturbating on camera when you didn't expect it?
On camera?
Wasn't he on camera?
Yeah, he's on camera, but like, how do you get caught masturbating on camera though?
Yeah, I don't know someone might have done that on purpose. If he's like this, he's like, I want to show the world at 60. Look at me, man.
Everybody that's probably what he did on purpose.
Yeah. No, what I want to know is what's going on with these old men trying to show their dicks? Because what you call it, Giuliani was just in the Borat movie.
Was he packing? Like, was it a nice pack?
What? Well, it wasn't seen. It wasn't videotaped. Basically, what happened was they went to a break room, break off room, and he didn't think he was on camera, and he got up, and people that were in the break room with him saw it. And then he came back in. He didn't know that they saw that, you know, his dick was out and da 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 da. But Yeah.
And real quick before we leave that topic is that, you know, a lot of like people around that age aren't in like in tune with like, you know, technology. So that probably might have been.
I don't know. I'm kind of there, but I mean, it is what it is.
He must be good with technology.
Yeah, ain't nobody trying to see their geriatric penises. They need to put them away.
Moving on from bloody Jeffrey Toobin, eh? Let's move quickly as well. Up next, we are making a visit to NYC's amazing artist, Gary Higgins, with our new segment, Spotlight. He's giving us an exclusive tour of his studio, no less, with an insight on some of his paintings. Let's take a look at his journey and his work, full of art with fashion and culture.
On this spotlight, we're headed uptown to Washington Heights for an exclusive tour of New York-based artist Gary Higgins. We're going to tour his home. We're going to view some of his work as we here celebrate queer artists in the spotlight.
So, welcome to my house. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you coming. I'm Gary Higgins. I'm originally from Greensboro, North Carolina, but I've been in New York for 12 years now, and I live in Washington Heights. I am primarily a painter, so I'm a full-time freelance artist. I'm also a development specialist for a global health organization.
What keeps you inspired? What keeps you creating new work?
So that's a great question.
I know, right?
So when I think about inspiration and what inspires me, I'm inspired by so many things. Just nature, primarily, culture, just everything I see, I take photos of. It could be an ice cream cone melting on the sidewalk. That can inspire me to do a painting or a sculpture or some type of gown. So I'm inspired by everyday life. I think that art has the capacity and the power to really uplift people and inspire people and to make people happy. And so anything that I can do to use my skill set to create some type of positive change in the world is a win-win.
Jordan, can you stay right there?
Yes.
You were the art talent in the new film, Keepin' Love a Secret, Volume 2. What was it like, and what was it like seeing your work on the big screen?
Keepin' Love a Secret, being a part of that project was a really significant thing for me. And to really understand that I was being a part of, you know, taking control of the images that we create and have out in social media of what it means to be a strong black gay male and doing it so beautifully, you know, that was incredible for me.
I needed more than that. I needed a role model. I hated my childhood.
To be an artist from a tiny little country town to go to seeing my paintings on a humongous screen was just like a full circle moment.
How would you describe your home, your space, the aesthetic?
So my space is really just authentically me. Like if you could look inside of me, inside my mind, inside my heart, you would see this, you know? It's a collection of all the things that I love. You know, I feel like we have to really make sure our space is something that really caters to who you are and is a place of solace, especially in New York City.
So Gary, can you tell us a little more about some of your pieces?
I was teaching a workshop in the Bronx and I went by this 99 cent store and they had betta fish, so I bought one. And the fish ended up living for years, I mean years. And I wake up, every morning when I wake up, I'm singing, I'm making noise. He would get so excited and he would come to where I was beside the tank and swim and get so excited. And I got really, really sick and it was really bad. And as soon as I got better, you know, I know it sounds kind of silly, but I felt like he was a support system. And as soon as I got better, he passed away. And so he was a beautiful red betta fish. And so this is a memorial to him. And it's a beautiful red flowing gown. It's underwater. The bubbles are like, you know, dreams and all these different types of things. So I wanted to like kind of pay homage to Fish. His name was Fish. Like the chandelier in the kitchen, I found this basket at Home Goods, took the handles off, drilled a hole in the top, and I found a chandelier, this light fixture on a blanket, on a sidewalk, yard sale type of deal. It was 10 bucks. I put it inside of the basket, and that was the chandelier that I just wanted for now. And then I really wanted to capture, if you see, there's a lion and he's juggling and balancing all these balls in the air on his hands and feet. And then deep down inside, you see this cute little puppy dog. And I kind of wanted to just address toxic masculinity in a very like fun and colorful and silly kind of way. So it really just kind of demonstrates like the need for us to wear this mask of this strong, you know, protective, manly figure. And we're really trying to juggle it and make it work. And really deep down inside, we're just a cute little puppy dog wanting to be loved. So that's what that painting is about. And it's the newest one that I just released. And I'm so happy to have it sell so quickly and go to a beautiful home. So very, very happy with it. Hey, I'm Gary Higgins. Thank you for having me. This has been my spotlight.
Start a taster for Halloween, gentlemen. Have I got some fun for you? We are gonna play a Halloween game. Here's how it works. You're gonna see 10 famous movie posters, all right? And the rules of the game are this. You have to be the first to say the name of the movie to get a point. At the end of it, the host with the most points wins. I'm not gonna tell you what we win, but you just win something.
Okay, that's cool.
Ooh, got some blue, we got some red.
Okay.
It's a movie poster.
Jaws.
God
damn it, Brandon.
Wait. Yeah.
That is Jaws. Right. Yeah.
Jaws 2, yeah. Jaws 3, Jaws 4, which one?
Yeah, but you saw
the first one. It's the original one.
Yeah, it's Jaws. All right, Brandon. You
that
got
was
that
easy.
One.
That was okay. That was too easy.
Horror film.
Get Out.
Get Out.
Yeah, damn. That it is Get Out.
Is that a horror film?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
This is, I thought it'd be harder. I guess we're pretty.
I guess you winning all of them now, Travis.
No, Brad. Oh, what's that? Oh.
It's like a. Ooh. It's like a mask. Is it bald head?
Dead. Deadpool.
No.
I have no idea.
Tales of the Hood?
Dracula?
Oh. No.
Is it Tales of the Hood?
Terminator? Tales of the Crypt.
Oh,
yes! Tales of the Hood.
Was it Tales of the Crypt?
Okay.
What is it?
That's today's theme.
Hood.
It was Tales from the Hood.
Okay. You didn't say the name right, Brandon. You shouldn't get
Chucky.
That.
This is Child's Play.
Child's Play. Ah.
Are you kidding me? What, Brandon, you were the first one to say you was not.
Is it Child's Play?
Man, the new guy can't win this game. What's the point if the new guy wins?
He's a special guest. Let him fucking win.
Yay!
Dan came into this game mad confident.
Listen, just for the record. Just for the record, nobody's letting me win, okay? I'm winning on my own merit, okay?
No, you suck. All right, I got this. Come on.
He's fucking cheating.
He's got the answer already.
Oh, this one is... Okay.
I'm gonna just sip on this because clearly I'm not winning.
I know what you did last summer.
Halloween.
Oh, are you kidding me?
He's right, is he?
Yeah.
Brandon's right again.
Wow. Why not
this game?
This shit is rigged.
I agree, Brandon. Brandon's out of this round.
It's like the anticipation.
It's not Freddy versus Friday the 13th? Or is it
Nightmare on Elm Street?
Yay, I think I got that one.
Yeah, I'm not gonna play no more at this point.
Yay, I got one.
Straight up bullshit right now.
That is Flash.
Oh wait. Scary movie?
Yeah.
Something.
It better not be fucking Scary Movie.
It?
Oh,
what is it?
Yes.
You know what?
Oh, so I was right.
If I was on a set, I would have walked off.
Now, I would have walked off. Not with your boots and your coat.
Abby, did you get one? Did you get anything?
No.
Get one.
Oh, you got one.
Not answer.
Just one.
No, I said, did you get one? As in, did you guess one?
Halloween. I got Get Out.
I'm gonna just say Halloween at the beginning of every puzzle.
Halloween, Scary Movie.
That was Friday the 13th. Part two.
Friday the 13th. That's the next guess.
Oh, yo, why my screen went away? I can't see anything.
It's Friday the 13th. What's part two?
You lost anyway, then.
All right, you had part two, man.
I was winning.
You are really good at this.
You are, Brandon. Kudos to you.
Where my screen went.
Wait, I'm trying to, like, see.
I'm going to turn you all off because I can't see both screens at once. I don't know what's going on.
Sure, that's why you're not getting them right.
Is that a mood? Focus, focus.
Oh, Focus, Focus, yes.
I love that movie, too.
Yeah, I do. It's really, it's a great.
It's like, boo. Ooh, sign me up, baby. Sign me up. There's more. Yippee.
I got my two. I feel like I that was an accomplishment.
Dude, my computer's broken. I can't see anything.
Halloween.
Let's see. Wait.
Oh, The Walking Dead?
I heard me say that first.
Night of the Walking Dead.
Oh, yeah, maybe.
Wait, is it?
I have no idea.
I'm sure.
Sounds like The Walking Dead. Is the
Dawn of the Dead.
Dawn of the Dead. Dawn of the Dead. You know, now that I think about it, Brandon, I see your tactic. You pretend like you didn't know anything, and then boom, y'all, he winning everything.
All right, now that Brandon has swept us all in that game, like, winning like 6, or was it 10? I don't know. I feel like Brandon just got all the points. Like, he just, like, murdered us in that game. So let's move on to the next topic, topic number 4. All right, we are only 4 days away from the national election, 2020 elections. Joe Biden and Kamala Harris are ahead in the polls, but if you recall, 4 years ago, Hillary Clinton was ahead in the polls, and she still lost. So what do you guys think? Do you think that it'll make a difference this time, being ahead in the polls?
I don't know. I mean, I just feel as though are the polls at this point even valid? Because we all were upset last, you know, election. Everybody, okay? Across the globe. This was like a globe. I think except for like, you know, Russia and Ukraine and, you know, those girls. But, you know,
in the Midwest.
You know, but I honestly feel like, I mean, I feel like we need a really big switch. I don't know if you guys are paying attention to what's going on in Chile, where the people of Chile have, you know, fought and they're protesting to change the constitution. And I think they actually are going about doing so because of their protests. And what I was thinking was, if we decided to rally up and do something like that, I think that, you know, we could truly honestly say that we are an active democracy that truly, you know, works as a free will country, a people in a country that is supposed to be so free and we're supposed to be so open and so heard, I should say. I just feel like with so much of the upset that happened last year with the whole the electoral votes, right? I feel like we should just eradicate that, like, because I feel like, isn't it somewhere in the Constitution? You know what I'm saying? So I mean, I feel like I don't know. I really don't know. I just, everything is in the air when it comes to this election. But what I do know is that I'm really happy to see that so many people have jumped ahead of, you know, the line to really go out and vote early. And I mean, it's just amazing record numbers right now, you know? So I think that's absolutely amazing.
I agree with you. I mean, I'm glad to see everyone out, and I see and people voting early and people voting in numbers. It is a positive sign for Joe Biden, and they're saying that there's a lot fewer people that are undecided this go around because people have had a chance to experience Donald Trump. Like last time, it was like, what do we have to lose? Let's try it.
Right.
Now it's like, okay, we experienced 4 years of him. There's no kind of indecision. We know who both of these people are, so there's a lot fewer undecided. But I agree with you. I feel like there's, you know, a lot of our democracy is based on, like, the honor system. Like, I'm really realizing, like, a lot of our democracy is not set in stone. Like, they can bogart and do all kinds of crazy things. And, you know, if it's all based on an honor system, when you have people that don't care about honor, it all goes to pot. Like, it just all falls by the wayside. When you literally say, like, okay, we're not going to put anyone in this, you know, Supreme Court position for almost a whole year because, let the American people decide, da, 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 da. And then the exact same thing happens less than a month, or what is it, 6 weeks, or about a month, roughly a month, for the next election. And then y'all just do it. And the American people, like, wait a minute. This is exactly the opposite thing you said of this new rule that you made up. Like, it's
exactly
crazy. But, you know, and I agree. Like, I feel like Electoral College should go away. It's a vestige of slavery. Like, I feel like it's a remnant of slavery, and we just need to get rid of all those kind of, like, things that were based on keeping, you know, rich elite people in power. So, like, I agree. We need to set all these honor systems into law. Like, no, it's not up to you, you know, you being an honorable person to do this, that, or another thing. We're gonna put in the law. You have to do the right thing. This is what the law is.
Right.
This is what the law is here. So, like, I absolutely agree, and I'm hoping that all of the people showing up to the polls, you know, like they are, like, I'm going to do the early voting, you know, before before the actual election day. I'm hoping that, you know, results in Joe Biden, you know, leading, winning by a landslide. Like, that's what I'm hoping. What do you guys think, Dan and Travis?
It's good news. I remember we discussed this in the last episode as well. Toys, you were saying that this time there are so many more people voting, and that, I'm guessing, can only be a good sign. Like, for change.
I hope so. I mean, the more people vote, the more people, the majority of this country tend to lean more Democratic. Like, the what people want, people are more into women having their choice. They're more into things being fair. Like, you know, they're more into, like, you know.
Right.
You know, all the different things that Democrats kind of, like, espouse, the majority of Americans want, but most of Americans don't vote.
Which seems to be changing this time around, though. So that's why I figure it could be a good sign for change if a lot more people are voting.
Unless they're doing it for the gram. Now,
I don't care why.
Even if you are, that's fine. A vote is a vote, okay?
Get into
how
it.
Real quick, fuck Trump. Yeah, I said, it's pretty obvious. I'm not a history buff, and I'm not really big on politics, but I what's right was right, what's wrong was wrong, what's there, bitch, is there. Trump clearly is a businessman. Joe Biden's clearly for the people, two opposites. So you got to pick your poison at the end of the day. You want your health care, you don't want your health care. That kind of thing. And we live in an era where I read something, they were like a social era, and it was more, everyone thinks they're activists, everyone thinks they have they do have a voice, but everyone isn't an activist, so on and so forth. So it's kind of my anxiety is real high, so I really don't know. I do see a lot of people voting, so in my heart I feel like, yes, there's hope that things will change for the greater good. However, money is power, and that's something, that's life, and that's real. So it's sad to say, but I mean,
okay, the producers want me to ask this question real quick, because I don't want to, because I don't even want to envision it. But do you guys see a path for Trump to win? Like, what is your thought? What are your thoughts on, like, you know, Trump, you know, pulling us out, you know, in the final hour?
Dude, he did it 4 years ago. He's already sure done it.
In. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, we didn't see it happening then, and you know, it happened. So at this point, we sitting already. I mean, like, you know, like, it's just like, I mean,
we really are ready.
Absolutely.
And even to go back into, like, you know, looking into the polls and being worried about that, to be honest, the polls were correct and Hillary did get the popularity vote. So we do have to acknowledge that. Yeah. But at the same time, you know, it's all of these loopholes that have been created specifically for certain types of people, Republicans, to win. You know, because like you just said, when there's an influx of people voting, they typically vote for a Democratic president. It always happens that way. And the thing is, you know, a lot of people showed out for Obama's first and second presidency. A lot of people showed out for Bill Clinton's presidency. A lot of people showed up, you know, and so on and so forth. So JFK, you know, with that being said, it's to go back and look at how everything is kind of, you know, traditionally been in this country. I feel like the next president after, whether it's Trump or Biden, should be someone who's closer to the 35-year-old age bracket, because I feel like they are on the ground, they understand what's going on because they've been taught by the older people. We've seen, you know, what's been done before us. So let us, this situation, us millennials, get in and really change the dynamic, the perspective of this country. I feel like we definitely can.
Do y'all think Trump's a racist?
I think he's a strategist.
Funny you say that, Brandon, the strategist, because in the beginning, the whole they're running the campaign. Yeah, strategy.
We here. I think it's all a strategy.
He's a businessman. So yeah. I'm not for Trump, but Trump's is a businessman.
He is.
I'm not saying he's not racist, but he had a lot of black people in Celebrity Apprentice and done a lot of business with black people that's not spoken of. But that's a good thing, a bad thing, I don't know.
Here's my thing, because people always say that Trump is a businessman. He owes $400 million.
But here's the thing, though.
Bad
business. Here's the thing.
What?
He does not owe it himself. His companies do. So with the thing is, he's never going to write it under himself. It's never going to, we saw that, you know, in the papers. He's never going to write, you're never going to go into any archives and see that Donald Trump has put his specific name on any types of tax records or anything. They pay all of their bills and everything specifically in credit cards for that purpose. So the thing is, it's like everything that comes out of these businesses goes back into the business. So, you know, let's say I don't necessarily feel like paying my bill this month for this particular situation. It's pretty hefty. The business is gonna, you know, go ahead and file for bankruptcy. Doesn't necessarily mean I don't have
them. That's like scamming.
It doesn't mean that I don't have to. Think about that though. I get what you're saying.
Is this the business a separate entity from himself? Yes. But it's still $400 million in the red. So like even if,
yeah,
if like his whole, like when you look at his taxes, whether it's his business or personal, it's still nearly $500 million in debt. Like,
right.
You can't tell me that he's a good businessman. Like, you can't tell me.
I didn't say he was a good businessman. He's just a businessman. Now, come on now, let's call
him. He's a hustler. I feel like Donald Trump is a hustler. I would give him that. Like, he said strategist.
Yeah.
For me, I feel like he is a hustler, like, to the extreme. I don't even think he wanted to be president. I think he just did this to increase his notoriety and to be able to do all kinds of other stuff. And he fell into this thing. And now, because he's being protected from all this other stuff because he's president, he wants to keep that going as long as he can. So, like, I get what you're saying, but in my head, it doesn't mean that he's a businessman. I feel like he is just a con artist. And, you know, he's been able to kind of hustle his way into the biggest, most important job on the planet. So he is the best con artist on the planet, bar.
And he knows how to fight dirty. It's a skill, boys.
You know, in addition to all the other things that he is, namely, you know, Kamala Harris just called him out as being a racist, as many people have called him out being a racist.
Yeah.
You know, and I just feel like that's accurate, that he's a racist. What do you guys... Yeah.
I mean, he probably is. Do I really know? No. So, I mean, he says certain things, or he makes certain comments that will insinuate some, like, oh, bitch, racist. But, I mean, I think it's just easy. I mean, I get it. It's easy to call someone a white person a racist. It is what it is. However, I mean, he wasn't that. I mean, I don't know.
Here's my thing with the racist thing. Before we move on to this topic, the racist thing to me, I feel like he's shown. There's evidence of him being a racist. Like he literally was sued by the Nixon administration for not letting black people like rent or buy in his properties during that administration. He like started his campaign calling Mexicans like rapists and killers. He like called African countries shithole countries.
But does that make somebody racist?
Absolutely. No. When he only attacks black women all the time, like it's like his patterns.
But let's think about it. I'll say this. I'll be quick. I'll be really quick. Mm-hmm. I'll say this. You understand that Trump came from a very entertaining background. Like he's a reality star, for crying out loud. And on his reality show, they were there to fight. It was a competition. It was argumentative. It was very combative. So with that being said, he saw that brought in viewers constantly. So he knows that stirring up a pot and bringing on commotion reels people in. If like the numbers for the first debate, out of this world, it was the most viewed thing on cable network television ever. And
what the hell are y'all doing him being racist, Brandon?
What I'm saying is he says things to stir the pot to get people to talk. Because he's a narcissist. He wants to always be in the news. He wants to always be up for discussion. Well, he always is going to say things and do things to make that happen.
I agree with you in the sense that, you know, it's hard to, you know, well, I don't think it's hard to say because I just think he's obvious with it. But I get what you're saying in the sense that, you know, it may not be that he's not racist. It's just that he knows that kind of placating to the right in this way attracts attention. It gives him a fan base. You know, that's why he's not, you know, decrying, you know, QAnon or talking about the Proud Boys and all this other stuff like that. This man knows everything about every topic more than any other person. He's an expert on everything. But ask him about a racist thing and all of a sudden he's like, I don't know anything about that. I don't know anything about QAnon. I don't know anything about David Duke. I don't know anything about Proud Boys. Like, but if you ask him about plumbing, he's like, I know more about plumbing than the plumbers. I know more about flying a plane than a pilot. Like he knows about everything.
But no shade to plumbers, but most plumbers are rednecks. they voted him in office. So if they know, then of course he's gonna be like, oh, I don't know anything about that. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Like, so I get what your point was about like, you know, like he placates certain things, but at the same time, I think that in modern times, you know, people tend to think that being a racist means you sit around saying the N-word all day. And I think there's so many other ways to be a racist. If you are denying people opportunities, if you are like writing people off, if you think that people are less deserving because of their skin color, then you're a racist. You don't have to say the N-word. And I think for me, Donald Trump exemplifies this on a regular basis that others like black and brown people are always other. You know what I mean? They're always treated like they're not, you know, it's not their country and you go back to where you came from and da 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 da. All of a sudden he said to, you know, AOC and those, you know, congresswomen. So I feel like he displays his racism, his on full display. So I get what you're saying, but I also feel like, you know, aside from just saying the N-word and on record,
it's like, white privilege at the end of the day.
That's
just what it is. I work with plenty of white people, plenty. I'm pretty sure y'all, you know what I'm saying, y'all too. Mm-hmm. And I've seen stuff like that. They don't think that they're racist, but they'll say some side comment shit. You'd be like, what'd you just say? But I'm not saying.
At some point, you're old enough to know better, and hiding behind excuses is not okay, and it's not acceptable. Because if you go by that, then it's fair. No law is applicable because that means you could just say, "Oh, I didn't know. I won't do it again next time." What does that mean?
Right.
No, I don't know, man. Right. I think there's levels of it. But you know, I agree with what you're saying, Toys. Like, you know, there are other ways to go about being racist other than standing in someone's face and using a certain type of word or slanderous comment. You know what I mean? Right. Your behavior, and I'm a big fan of this, your behavior says a lot. So you can behave in a very racist way without verbally saying it.
I agree. Yeah. So given that Trump is 70 something years old, I think it's like, I'm not sure what the number is, 72, 74. He's
old. He's not lying about that too, shit. God damn
it. He could be. Like, he is what he is. He's not going to change. Like, how important do you think that voting is in this moment?
It's detrimental. Absolutely.
Well, voting has always been important. It's just more so it's like what's behind it, I guess, right? Like, I don't know.
I think that we just have more at stake this time around. I feel like now that we know our power as a group of people,
correct,
you know, move as a unit and actually change the direction of this country, because we are a democracy. So, yeah.
It'll be very disappointing how this year went with all this, you know, the movements and with COVID and all this fucked up shit. If we don't vote, like if you that catch me, like if something goes wrong, it's like it's embarrassing for the other side, the other people, us.
I agree.
Right.
I
mean,
this, it'll be embarrassing. So much. What was all that for? If it's not getting the result that we really want. I mean,
exactly. Yeah,
I agree. I mean, I feel like there's so much at stake right now. I mean, you know, not only are we still going through this pandemic and the president is still saying, like, we're rounding a corner when we have the highest numbers that we've ever had, and it keeps rising and rising. You know, there's racial unrest and, you know, all these other things that are happening that if he, you know, the environment, there's so many things that are at stake right now. If he gets another 4 years, these things may not be up for debate in 4 years. Because he's done so much damage in the 4 years he's already had. By the time we get to, you know, 2024,
we're gonna blow the fuck out. Like, literally.
We might have accelerated climate change. We might have, you know, I don't even know. Like, you don't know what could happen. If we get another, you know, global pandemic that happens during his term, what are we going to do? Like, there's so much to say. So I feel like voting now.
In order in life, for individuals, for countries, for everybody, in order in life to see a big change and a big shift, you need to make wholesale changes. Yeah. And I feel like, you know, this is an opportunity in this country for everybody to get out and vote and make a wholesale change. There are a lot of steps forward for unfortunate reasons this year with things that have happened, but there is still redemption at hand, because there's an opportunity to make a difference. So get out there and vote, because you have the opportunity to make a wholesale change and change the direction of this country. And, you know, I can't vote. I said this on episode one, but all you guys and girls can vote. Get out there and vote.
Vote for Dan.
That is the best way to end the show, because it's so important. We need to get out there and vote.
Wholesale changes.
This is a way to make the change that we want to see in the world. So
it's very simple. Get up, your fat, skinny, whatever kind of ass you got, and go vote.
Yeah, absolutely.
Brandon, before we let you go, and I want to be the first one to kick you out because you pantsed it in that game. No, I love it, Brandon. You've been beautiful.
I saw it.
Brandon, tell us, what have you got coming up, big guy? Are you on any other shows? Any other projects? Give us your handles. How can we get in contact with you? How can we see you with your clothes on or off?
Oh my God, where do I start? It was just like so many like things. So you can follow me everywhere on Brandon Carson with a K, J. That literally everywhere. Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, everywhere. Facebook, all of that great stuff. I am currently working on the sixth season of Triangle, which you can go and view on brtbtv.com, .tv. And then you can also be on the lookout for several different things. I'm working on a reality show right now. I can't really give you
guys detail.
I can't really give you guys too much detail, but we are in full swing as we speak. I definitely will. And then I'm also working on my own underwear and swimwear line.
Are you wearing them now? Do you want to stand up and just take your pants off and show us quickly?
I don't have any pants to take off, but what I will say is, you know, I'm a very busy man. A lot of great things are happening. I'm also writing a project as well too. So we're busy. Things are busy. We're busy.
And how is it working with our castmate, Justin?
Absolutely amazing. Justin is a light in the room. He is the wind beneath my wings.
Not to interrupt the party, but I was on Triangle 2 one season, so we got something in common.
Yeah, we do. We got a lot in common, Travis. We really do.
We, you know, we've been around the block.
We have. The same block. That's the real G.
Honey. Let me stop. I'm a different show. Travis, shut up.
Wrap it up on that note. thank you guys for all tuning in to Argue. I'm Twist Francis.
I am Dan the Man.
Y'all know the vibes, the kid, Travis Dimitri, and sidebar, don't forget to follow our, what's our handle again?
You.
Argue Talk Show. Brandon, take it away.
And thank you guys so very much for this opportunity. I really, really appreciate it. Thank you guys for opening the doors of the church. Yes. I appreciate it. I've gotten my word, all is well.
Thank you for joining us, Brandon, and waxing all of us on that game.
Well, that's it, y'all. This is the second episode of Our View. We're done. Bye-bye.